All right. I'm super excited about this message. I've been wanting to do it for a while. I was going to do it yesterday, but I needed some rest, and I really needed to do a little bit more studying on what I'm about to talk to you about right now. The name of this message is going to be Happy Hellish Days. And it's a play on words when it comes to happy holidays, as we like to say. But I'm going to call this Happy Hellish Days, and the reason why is this. A lot of the holidays that we celebrate actually have pagan roots. They have a pagan origin about them. And a lot of today's Christians either don't know this or the stuff that I'm about to explain to you, or they do know, they simply just don't care and just ignore it and, you know, act like it's not a big deal. But I think it is, and so I want to share some stuff with you. And I'm just so amped up about this message because, I mean, it's something that really needs to get out there, I believe, and it's something that is not talked about a lot at all in the church world because it's something that rubs people the wrong way. It makes people uncomfortable because it makes people think twice about traditions that we carry out over the years. And having, looking back and thinking of all the fun that we have doing traditions and then finding out that there are things that we do that might not be so cool in God's eyes, and then having to sit there in the pew and think to ourselves, well, you know, I had fun doing this. My kids or grandkids have fun doing some of this stuff. You know, we've done this for years. You know, I'd hate to have to not do some of these things anymore because they were such fun and it brings back great memories. But now I'm learning all this stuff that I didn't know, and you know, maybe it wouldn't make sense for me to do certain things since I'm a Christian, but now I feel all conflicted because, you know, my feelings and my emotions want me to just keep doing what I'm doing, but then there's the logical, rational part of me that's saying, hey, if I'm going to try to be a true Christian the best that I can, I might want to think twice about some of the stuff that I'm doing. So, you know, it's something that can rub folks the wrong way. It can, you know, cause people to feel a little uncomfortable when they learn some of the stuff that I'm going to explain. So it's not talked about nearly as much as it should or could be. So that's why I'm excited about it, because y'all know I just love to just go on rants about stuff people probably don't want to hear about, but I enjoy it anyway. It just blesses my heart. But anyway, so some of you are probably thinking, what do you mean? Some of you know what I mean, but for those of you who don't know what I mean when I say pagan, the Bible, a lot of times the Bible would call them heathens, people of the other lands, the other nations that did not worship God, the one true God, our God of the Bible. They didn't worship him. They worshiped many other false gods, the heathen, as the Bible puts it, or pagans. These people were worshiping all these false gods. They had all these false idols. And, you know, as we know, our God, Jehovah, he is a jealous God, and he will have no other God before him. And so, of course, these things, some of the things that we do, some of the traditions or rituals that we carry out during certain holidays actually go back to rituals and things that pagans were carrying out in worship to their false gods. So with that said, there are things that we do today, and sometimes we do them in the church, that we probably shouldn't do because, you know what I mean? They were things done to worship other gods besides the God that we go to see or go to spend time with at church. So why would you bring, you know, pagan traditions and rituals in a church, right, while worshiping the one true God? It's kind of a contradiction there. So what I want to start out with is Easter, because that's the holiday coming up. This is March right now, March of 2016, and it's during the March slash April time of year that you know, Easter and preparing for Easter and talking about Easter is going on. And so this is perfect timing, early March, to talk about this. So Easter is the first one that I want to talk about. And let me explain this. Easter is actually a celebration of the goddess, because they had false gods and false goddesses. Easter is really the celebration of the false goddess Astaroth or Ashtaroth. And when you look this up in the Hebrew, it means star. And there are other pronunciations of this name because depending on what, city or country or culture you're in, sometimes people pronounce things a little bit different. So other pronunciations of Astaroth or Ashtaroth are Ashtoreth, Ashtarothite, Ishtar, Aftart, Astart, and Estor or Estore. Notice almost all these you can hear star or star in them, but there are some that sound very much like the word Easter, or how it should be pronounced really, Easter, like the name that I mentioned, Ishtar. Get it? Ishtar, Easter, or Astart, Easter, Astor, or Astore, Easter. Get it? See how they sound similar to Easter or Easter? That's because this goddess, Astaroth or Ashtaroth, that's what this was in honor of. This day, the celebration was in honor or in worship of this goddess. So, if you got your Bible, and I hope you follow along with me, I'm going to start out in Judges chapter 2. And while you're turning there, I'll just explain some stuff for a moment so that you understand what's going on. This particular god or goddess that Easter is really about is a fertility god. Now, let me say this. Our God, the one true God of the Bible, we go to him for all of our needs. If we're sick, we pray to him for healing. If we're sad and depressed, we pray to him for joy. If we're in trouble, we have anxiety, we pray for the peace that passes all understanding. Financial troubles, we go to him. We go to him for whatever we need. Just the one God for all our needs. But with these people, the pagans or the heathens of the Bible, they had all these different gods and goddesses, and they all specialized in something different. You may have a fertility god, a god of war, a god that you go to for finances, a god, maybe a god of love or, whatever, a god of this, a god of that, whatever your needs were, you had a particular god to go to for that. You know what I mean? So that's how they did things. And there were different things that they would do to worship these gods. And it's just like how we go to church as Christians. They had their church or their temple or their shrine that they would go to and worship their God and do rituals there, kind of like how we do certain rituals in church, like having communion and things like that. Now, here's the thing about fertility gods, and you may think, well, why in the world would they be worshiping this fertility god, and what does that mean, a fertility god? Fertility has fertile in it. That's what it's about being fertile, not only the land being fertile and producing crops, having a harvest, but also being fertile in our own bodies. And this is what I mean. If you look in your Bible in 1 Kings chapter 18, I believe it is, that's where we read the story of Elijah, the prophet Elijah, and the victory that he had on Mount Carmel. We know the story. He got everybody together. They had people who had been on Jezebel's side and they were worshiping Baal or Balaam, and they had all the prophets of Baal and all these people. And then you had these people over here who couldn't make up their mind if they were going to worship the one true God of the Bible or these false gods. And Elijah was saying, hey, you can't be caught between two opinions. Either you're going to serve our God, the one true God, or you're going to go after these other gods. But you need to pick. You can't ride the fence. So that happened. There was a challenge, a duel, if you will. They were calling for their false god or false gods to do something. They were cheering him on. They were chanting. They were doing stuff to try to get their god to do something, to make a sound, to make a noise, to say something. Nothing happened. And Elijah, when it was his turn, he called out to God and fire came down from heaven. And it was just this spectacular moment. Well, at the start of this story, in the first couple of verses, we know that there was a lack of rain, and it goes on to say that there was a famine in the land. But by the end of that story, after that big victory, and God just shows up and shows out, it ends letting us know that they could hear the sound of the abundance of rain. They could hear rain coming, and there's reasons why it played out that way, and it's this. Oftentimes in the Old Testament, you may come across a story and it'll start out saying there was a famine in the land. And a lot of times things play out in the spiritual before they play out in our physical realm. So whenever you had a place, a land where God's presence had not been there, that land would end up having a famine in it. There would be a bunch of dryness. There wasn't much growing. There was not much fertility or fertileness there. Okay? So we have this place where God's presence isn't there because the people who are supposed to be worshiping God and speaking his word and saying what needs to be said, all these mighty men and women and prophets of God, they're hiding out in caves, being quiet because they're scared of Jezebel. So they're hiding out in caves. So God's not getting the glory for anything like he should be. And you got all these people, these other people worshiping false gods. So the one true God, his presence is not in that land. So there was a famine, but then after God shows up and shows out and fire brings fire down from heaven and all that, after Elijah had called upon him, his presence had been there. And that's why it went on to say, here comes rain, because now we've had God's spirit here. And so now it can play out in the physical, bringing rain so that things can grow and we can get some nourishment around here. So it goes hand in hand, but also something else, like I said, also to do with being fertile, if you will, in our own bodies. A great example would be, I believe it's 2 Samuel chapter 6, maybe, but somewhere we read about David and how the ark of God was brought back to its home. The people of God were able to have the ark back, and there was this big celebration about the ark of God, which was a physical representation of the spirit of God. It was coming back home, and David was getting ready to have this celebration, and the ark had came back, and he was happy. He was dancing with all his might, and just having a good time in the Lord, praising the Lord, excited for the presence to be back. And then you had his wife, Michal, who was so upset. She was mad at him. She despised him in her heart and tried to make him feel bad. Oh, look at what you're doing. You're bringing shame to us. This is so shameful. You know, you're dancing around here half naked. You know, what? You look at you. You look foolish. And she just would not embrace him. So not only was she not cheering and praising God and being thankful for the ark being back, she was too busy being stuck up and holier than thou. And she would not embrace David at a moment that she should have. So because she wasn't praising him, because she would not embrace the one who was praising God and being excited about his presence coming back, her womb was closed up and she was not able to reproduce after that anymore. So we see something going on here. We see the God's presence not being somewhere and the land not being fertile, and then us not being fertile when we reject God, the things of God, us not being able to be very productive. So we see some things there that go hand in hand. And so basically what I'm getting at is this. like I said, different gods for different things with the pagans. And a big thing was fertility gods. That was a big thing because, of course, when God's presence isn't there, the one true gods, a lot of times there will be famine. So you would have people who would not be set where they needed to be when it came to their land. And they had wounds that were closed. And so they weren't going to the one true God for help. So guess what they did? They went to their gods, and they had fertility gods. And basically the fertility gods were to help them be fertile, or to help their land be fertile and produce or reproduce. So they would go to these groves or these temples or shrines and carry out rituals in worship of their gods. And they did different things. And for example, they might have shrine prostitutes, or cult prostitutes as they were called, people who would prostitute themselves and whore themselves out to do these different sex acts for fertility, because that was the mindset. Do something involved with sex or giving up the seed or sperm or whatever for the purpose of gaining more when it comes to fertility. So that's what they did. So again, fertility gods were a big thing because of the lack of the presence of the one true God. So going here to Judges, let's look at this here in chapter 2. We're going to start at verse 11, and we're going to read about this particular god, Ashtaroth, or Ashtaroth, where we get Easter from. It says this: "And the children of Israel did evil in the sight of the Lord and served Balaam. And they forsook the Lord God of their fathers, which brought them out of the land of Egypt, and followed other gods." Notice that's little g. Big G is our God, capital G. Lowercase g is the false gods. So it says they followed other gods and the gods of the people that were round about them, and bowed themselves unto them, and provoked the Lord to anger. So we had the children of Israel, in other words, God's people, turning their back on God, doing evil in his sight, and worshiping false gods, the gods of the heathen. 13, "And they forsook the Lord and served Baal and Ashtaroth." So we see the two gods I just got on talking about, Baal or Balaam in the story of 1 Kings with Jezebel and Elijah, and then the one that I'm really trying to talk to you about, Ashtaroth. Those were the gods that they were going after to serve. Verse 14, "And the anger of the Lord was hot against Israel, and he delivered them into the hands of spoilers that spoiled them, and he sold them into the hands of their enemies round about, so that they could not any longer stand before their enemies. Whithersoever they went out, the hand of the Lord was against them for evil, as the Lord had said, and as the Lord had sworn unto them, and they were greatly distressed. Nevertheless, the Lord raised up judges, which delivered them out of the hand of those that spoiled them, and they would not hearken unto their judges, but they went a-whoring after other gods and bowed themselves unto them. They turned quickly out of the way which their fathers walked in, obeying the commandments of the Lord, but they did not so." So what has happened here is this, and when it's saying that God gave them over to spoilers, that doesn't mean there were people spoiling them, like giving them all of what they want. What it really means is robbing. So God, because his people, his chosen people, who were supposed to set the example for all the other nations and the heathen or the Gentile, what they were doing was they were turning their back on God. They were going after other gods like Ashtaroth. And so he gave them over to other people. In other words, he let other people have the advantage over them, and they would rob them and take advantage of them. And it went on and on. God was willing to forgive them, so he put these judges over them to rule over them, to give them direction, and they wouldn't take heed to what the judges were telling them. They continued, as the Bible says, they continued to go a-whoring after other gods. So this is what hori means. I went back to the original Hebrew, and it goes back to the word zonal. So when it says they went a whoring after these other gods, it goes back to zonal, which means things like this: to commit fornication, to be a harlot, to play the harlot, to be a cult prostitute, or to be unfaithful to God. When we are not faithful to God, when we turn our backs on God, he views us as whores. We're whoring because we're not being faithful to him. We are his people. We're supposed to have a relationship with him. So when we go after other gods, it's almost like when you're in a relationship with another person and you cheat on them. That's how he views it. We're whoring because he's serious with us. He's faithful to us. We're just not faithful to him at times. So we go a whoring. We're whoring out. We're playing the harlot. And some of these people were going and being cult prostitutes, prostituting themselves out for these gods. And like I said, Ashtaroth being a fertility goddess. So we got these fertility gods, fertility goddesses. Now go with me to 1 Kings. I want to show you something else here. But I was just reading some things here to you so you can see how what I've been saying is lining up in Scripture. It's all going hand in hand. 1 Kings chapter 11. We'll just start here at the beginning. We know who Solomon is, King Solomon, a great and mighty king. We always talk about the wisdom of Solomon. That's what we say. He was blessed greatly by God. But then there came the downfall of Solomon. And let's see what it says here. It says, but King Solomon loved many strange women, together with the daughter of Pharaoh, women of the Moabites, Ammonites, Edomites, Zidonians, and Hittites, of the nations concerning which the Lord said unto the children of Israel, ye shall not go into them, neither shall they come in unto you, for surely they will turn away your heart after their gods. Solomon clave unto these in love, and he had 700 wives, princesses, and 300 concubines, and his wives turned away his heart. So what's happened here is God has already said, don't go after the strange or foreign women. In other words, he's saying, don't go after the women of these other lands, these other nations that worship other gods besides me. Because I know that when you do, you give your heart over to them, you're eventually going to turn your heart away from me and turn it towards the gods that they worship. And sure enough, that's what happened. Solomon, they all knew better, but especially Solomon, him being king, he should really know better. But he went on ahead and did it anyway. Over 1,000 women here, 1,000 women, and then it goes on to say this in verse 4, for it came to pass when Solomon was old that his wives turned away his heart after other gods, and his heart was not perfect with the Lord his God, as was the heart of David his father. For Solomon, listen to this, here it comes, for Solomon went after Ashtoreth, the goddess of the Zidonians, and after Milcom, the abomination of the Ammonites. And Solomon did evil in the sight of the Lord, and went not folly after the Lord, as did David his father. Then did Solomon build a high place for Chemosh, the abomination of Moab. And Chemosh is another false god. So it says that he set up a high place for him. Continuing on in verse 7, in the hill that is before Jerusalem, and for Molech, the abomination of the children of Amnon. Molech is another false god, a fire god. He was one of the gods that people did child sacrifices to. They would cause their kids to walk through the fire and be burned up for this god. Let's see here. Verse 8, and likewise did he for all his strange wives, which burnt incense and sacrificed unto other gods. And the Lord God was angry with Solomon because his heart was turned from the Lord God of Israel, which had appeared unto him twice and had commanded him concerning this thing that he should not go after other gods. But he kept not that which the Lord commanded. Wherefore the Lord said unto Solomon, forasmuch as this is done of thee, and thou hast not kept my covenant and my statutes, which I have commanded thee, I will surely rend the kingdom from thee and will give it to thy servant. So here we start seeing the downfall of Solomon. He had it all, but all because he went after people he shouldn't have, and he started going after gods that he shouldn't have, little g. It cost him greatly, and it broke God's heart, our God, the one true God. So that's what we see there when it comes to this God. We see it caused trouble with some of God's people, the one true God. So I kind of wanted to share some stuff with you. Easter. There are things that we do during Easter, but they were things that the pagans that worshiped Ashtaroth did to worship her. And what I mean by that is this. During Easter, you know, we get together, and a lot of times we, when we go to church later on after service, a lot of times they'll have an Easter egg hunt. And a lot of times, of course, people do it at home too. Sometimes people might not go to church, but a lot of times at churches they'll want to do the Easter egg hunt. And so they'll say, okay, after church, we're going to let the kids go out. We're going to go hide some eggs, and they can go find them. And the kids go out there. They hunt after what we call Easter eggs. And these are eggs. Usually they're either one of two things. Either they're eggs that we've dyed and painted different colors, or a lot of times we'll go to the store and get those plastic eggs that you can open up and put something in them. And a lot of times people will put candy in them, or, you know, money in them or something, or some change or whatever. And the kids can go find them, you know. We'll hide them and the kids will go find them. Well, this is what they did in worship of this fertility goddess, Ashtaroth. One of the symbols that they had for fertility was the rabbit or the hare. And another big symbol of fertility was eggs, which makes sense because, you know, when you give birth, a human or an animal gives birth, you know, sometimes we just give birth to that human or animal, but some animals, they lay an egg and that egg hatches into something. So an egg being a symbol of birthing, producing, you get it, fertility. Well, they had this fable, this belief of how this goddess Ashtaroth came about. And what it was this: they believed that one day this huge giant egg came from the sky. It fell from the heavens, and when it landed and it hatched, what came out of it was the goddess Ashtaroth. So it only made sense to worship this god or goddess in some kind of way with eggs, because it's already a big symbol for fertility anyway. So take two things together here that mean fertility: eggs and rabbits, and then you got the rabbit egg or the Easter egg. See what I'm saying here? So they would do things with eggs during their rituals. They may exchange eggs with people and things like that to reverence this goddess. It was a way to reverence her, something symbolic, using the eggs to reverence her, to acknowledge this goddess. And so that's where we have the Easter eggs, the bunny eggs from. They are the eggs of that goddess. So if we're going on these egg hunts, and sometimes, you know, kids, they'll exchange eggs, you know, if they like one egg, they can exchange it with somebody else, or they trade because the egg has something in it that the other one doesn't, and they want this or that. Really, it's just a reenactment of some of the things they were doing to worship that god, that fertility god. And why in the world would we have kids, little kids of all people, doing things that's causing us to act out the worship of not only a goddess, but a fertility goddess of that? Because that's what they would be doing these things for, to be more fertile. And why would why would we want our little kids, you know, at an age before they can even reproduce, you know what I mean, doing things that are reenactments of reverencing a fertility goddess? Now, of course, many of us don't know any better. We don't know that that's what it's about. And a lot of times, if we can be honest, the eggs and this and that, the rabbit doesn't have anything to do with Jesus. But what happened was over the years was we gave it a story. You know, we'll say something like, oh, well, you know, Jesus was in the tomb and you know, before the great resurrection. And so these eggs, we hide them. And you got to find the eggs like trying to find Jesus in the tomb, or, you know, the eggs hatching is Jesus being resurrected, or, you know, something crazy like that. But it's just something we make up to go with it because we've Christianized it. We've Christianized this holiday to make it be about Jesus and the resurrection. But that's not what it was originally about. It had to do, get it, Ishtar? Astarte, you know, see how, you know, that's what it was originally about. You can tell in the name. I mean, it's there. So that's where the Easter eggs and all that come from. It's a sign of fertility, birthing, something that, you know, kids probably shouldn't be participating in. But whatever, I'm just explaining to you what it was about. Now, let me say this. A lot of times, people will say that Easter and the Passover are the same things. As you know, in the Old Testament, we read about a tradition called the Passover that God's people would do. And they say Easter and Passover is the same thing. If you got a King James Bible, a King James Version Bible, go with me to Acts. And we can look into this. Go with me to Acts. And we'll go to chapter 12. Acts chapter 12 says, where am I at here? So yeah, starting at verse 1. Acts 12, verse 1. It says this. Now about that time, Herod the king stretched forth his hands to vex certain of the church. In other words, to afflict or oppress or torment people of the church. So we have this king who is against God's people, against Christians. Verse 2, it says, and he killed James, the brother of John, with a sword. And because he saw it pleased the Jews, he proceeded further to take Peter also. Then were the days of unleavened bread. And when he had apprehended him, he put him in prison and delivered him to four quaternions of soldiers to keep him, intending after Easter to bring him forth to the people. So he's got these people, these Christians, he's wanting to persecute them is what it basically comes down to, trying to have them killed. We see in verse 3 that he's got Peter, and it's saying that these were the days of unleavened bread. Now, then in verse 4, it goes on to say, intending after Easter to bring him forth to the people. Now, there, like I said, there will be people that will say, well, Easter and the Passover are the same thing. You know, we got it right when we say Easter. Now, let me first say this. In some translations, in verse 4, it will say Passover. However, if you look at the King James, maybe not the New King James, but the King James, it says Easter. The King James translation gets it right, because Easter and Passover are not the same thing. How do we know? Go to the book of Numbers. Keep your hand here. We'll come back to it. Hold on to this spot. But go with me to Numbers real quick. Let's see here. Numbers 28. Starting at verse 16, it says this, and in the 14th day of the first month is the Passover. And in the 15th day of this month is the feast. 7 days shall unleavened bread be eaten. So it's saying that on the 14th day of a month was the Passover, and then on the 15th day, the next day, started the day of unleavened bread, right? So now going back to Acts, remember it said that when he was doing these things, when he had Peter, it was during the days of unleavened bread. And we just read that the days of unleavened bread started after the Passover. So then in verse 4, it goes on to say that he was doing that and intending after Easter to bring him forth to the people. So this Easter that they're talking about, which was their celebration, the pagan celebration, King Herod's celebration, right? It's what they're celebrating. This Easter is during the days of unleavened bread, which come after the Passover, because we just read it in Numbers. You have the Passover and then the days of unleavened bread. But it already let us know here that what he's got going on here in this, when it says he's gotten Peter, and then it goes on to say, then were the days of unleavened bread. So he's saying, these are the days after the Passover. It's like another way of saying, these are the days after the Passover, the days of unleavened bread. So this Easter is taking place after the Passover. So it's not the same thing. The King James Version, this translation gets it right. It is a pagan holiday in reverence to Ashtaroth or Ishtar. Get it? Okay, so these Easter eggs, or really you could just say fertility eggs, that's what it's about. It's about fertility, worshiping this fertility goddess and using these eggs as a symbol of reverence to this god or goddess. That's what it's about. Simple as that. So, a lot of people will say, well, I don't understand what the big deal is. It's all in fun. Why not do something for Jesus? We can make this be about Jesus. Well, here's the thing. Why don't we just come up with our own thing? Why keep calling it Easter? Guys, Easter is where we're getting this the name of this pagan goddess from, but we don't worship a goddess. We worship the one true God of the Bible. So why would we bring the celebration of Easter or Ishtar, a false goddess, into the house of God, into church? Why have the Easter egg hunt in church or in the back of the church, the backyard of the church? Why? If you now know that this was originally done in reverence to a goddess, and then to top it off, a fertility goddess, but then we got the key. You see what I'm saying? The key is doing this. Now, you can't tell me Satan ain't behind this. You can't tell me the devil's not laughing it up when we do this. You know he is. I mean, really, you got to. Come on now. Really? You know, he got us good on this one. So it's something to think about. Why not just come up with something else? Why not? On that particular day that we would call Easter, we could call it something else. We could do something else besides eggs. Why not let them hunt after something else? Like, why not make some little crosses and hide them somewhere? And I don't know, we could come up with our own thing. It has nothing to do with taking away from celebrating Jesus because, well, these acts really have nothing to do with Jesus. That's the point. We've taken something that, and here's the funny thing. Let me say this. It reminds me of when we say, or when preachers say stuff like this, we cannot let the world in the church. We must not let things of the world enter into the church. We must not adapt to these things and adopt these things of the world, blah, blah, blah. We must be Christian and pure, and we have to be the salt of the earth and the light of this world, and we have to represent Christ, and da-da-da-da-da. Exactly. That's just it. That's what we've done. We've taken things that we should be considering of the world, right? And we've brought it in and adopted it and Christianized it, if you will. And it's to the point where years down the line, many Christians don't even understand what this stuff is really about. So why not we just come up with our own thing that actually is biblically, you know, relatable to, you know, to the situation to celebrate. I mean, it's just, I don't know. It's just food for thought. Not putting anybody down. You know, I understand people are going to listen to this, they're going to watch this sermon and ignore what I'm saying and going to go back to doing what they do, and that's your business. I'm not judging. I'm just showing you some things. I'm pointing some stuff out to you. Because I guarantee you there are people, let me say this, there are people of other religions. There are atheists and agnostics that know this stuff. There are people, because there are still pagans today, there are pagans and Wiccans, people that do witchcraft. There are all kinds of people that know very well about this stuff that I'm explaining to you. And a lot of this is why many of them are not Christians now, because they look at us like idiots. They're sitting there thinking, okay, you're talking about these people of the world and these heathens, as you like to call us, these worldly people is what you call us, but you are adapting things and calling it your own, and when we do certain things, it's bad, but you always act like it's bad until you take it as your own, and then you act like it's good when you do it. So you're being hypocrites. You don't know anything about anything, and that's what they think. That's how they feel. This is why people, one of the many reasons why people are not coming into the church, because we don't want to learn anything. We don't want to know the truth about anything. We hold on to man-made traditions more than we do things of God. That's just how we are. It's just about what grandma, grandpa did and said. That's it. But, you know, it's just something to think about. It's not putting anybody down. I'm not dogging anybody out. Nothing like that. Now that I've talked about Easter, here's something else I'm pretty excited to talk about, and that is Christmas. And many of you are probably going to be in an uproar right now talking about, what? Don't you dog out Christmas? It has Christ in the name. Christmas, it's all about Jesus Christ. It always has been. No, it has not always been about Jesus. Actually, this holiday has pagan origins in it, too. And before you get mad and get ready to turn it off, you know, turn off the sermon, you might want to listen. Okay, just give me a moment. Just give me a chance to explain. Don't flip out. You know, these days, people here recently, I think last year or the year before or something like that, people got into this uproar about how folks decided to say happy holidays more, like around Christmas time they wanted to say happy holidays instead of Merry Christmas to be more inclusive to people of other religions, right? And many Christians got mad and they were all like, oh no, you know, we can't let them take Christ out of Christmas. This is about Jesus. All of this is about our Lord and Savior, and they're just trying to bully us and make us conform to the ways of the world and do this whole tolerance thing, and we can't tolerate this. We've got to stand up for what's right, and here's the big one right here. You know, Jesus is the reason for the season. He's the reason for this season. Yeah, he is, but it's because we made him the reason for the season. But originally, he wasn't the reason for the season when you go and look at history and the origins of it. So as I get ready to explain this, let me say this. If somebody wants to say happy holidays or Merry Christmas, I'm not going to get offended because I know the past. I know the origins of it. I know that originally it wasn't all about Christ. Now, I'm all about me some Jesus, but if somebody else says happy holidays, I'm not going to get offended simply because I know better. It's like the saying goes, when you know better, you do better. You know, I'm not going to look at it as, oh, they're trying to do away with Jesus. No, because this holiday, it's not all about Jesus. We've made it be all about Jesus as Christians. But that's just not how it was, guys. I'll just get into it. We'll look into it. So this is what it comes down to. It started out as a couple of different things. One of it was Saturnalia, something called Saturnalia, where during December there was the worship of the god Saturn, the god of excess. And also, There's the celebration of Yule or Yuletide. And it was a 12-day celebration for the pagans. And they would get some logs, some Yule logs, and light them on fire and have them a big fire. And they would get together and just party it up, get drunk, you know, get naked, just just have some wild parties, party it up. So if you think about it, does that not sound like our 12 days of Christmas? Now, I know you're thinking Christmas is on one day, but you know what I mean. Some of y'all know what I'm talking about, where, like, for example, when you watch TV, some channels may have a thing called 12 days of Christmas, where for the 11 days right before Christmas and Christmas Day, they show TV shows and movies, and even old movies that are Christmas movies and Christmas shows, right? They make it all about Christmas. Everything that they show on that channel is all about Christmas. So they'll do that for Christmas and all the 11 days before it, and they call it the 12 days of Christmas. Some of y'all know what I'm talking about. And also, we even have that song, The 12 Days of Christmas, that we love to sing around Christmas time. Y'all know what I'm talking about. On the first day of Christmas, my true love gave to me a partridge and a pear tree, right? And then we keep going to the second day of Christmas, the third day of Christmas, and then finally on the 12th day of Christmas, you know, the 12 days of Christmas. So we have this 12 day of Christmas theme sometimes, even though really it's just one day. But we do that. If we have a fireplace, we light the fire up and we have people over and we do all that, kind of like what they were doing during the Yule and the Yuletide. Nothing wrong with that, but there was something else that they were doing during this celebration as well. They had a god, a false god that they were worshiping, and this particular god, they reverenced him out of fear. They were very fearful of him, and his name was Odin. And Odin, let me tell you about Odin. Odin looks like a man, and he has this long beard. And he would come during nighttime to investigate and scope you out in your neighborhood, in your village. And he would determine whether or not you were going to prosper or perish. In other words, it was like his fate was in your hands. What was going to come to you, what was going to happen to you was in his hands. Either you were going to be prosperous or perish. So people were fearful of him and thinking, okay, I got to get some act right and figure out what he wants so, you know, I'm not doomed by him. Does that not sound a little familiar? Does that not sound similar to what we do with a character called Santa Claus? Think about it. The man with the long beard who comes during the night and he comes bringing judgment, because depending on whether or not you were naughty or nice, he might give you gifts or he might not give you anything at all. Or as we used to say, he'll just leave you a bag of coal to say you've been bad. Get it? We even have that song, Santa Claus is Coming to Town, right? He knows when you've been sleeping. He knows when you're awake. He knows if you've been bad or good. So be good for goodness sake. Oh, you better watch out. You better not pout. You better not cry. I'm telling you why. Santa Claus is coming to town. Get it? Odin is coming to town, and he's gonna come at night, so he knows if you're sleeping and if you're awake, right? He knows if you've been bad or good, so be good for goodness sake, because he's gonna determine whether or not you prosper or not, so you better not. But you see what I'm saying? And so really, Santa Claus really is a very watered down version of a false god. See, now we just make him this big, round, happy, jolly man that just loves the kids and wants to give them gifts. But when you think about all the details of him, they line up with a lot of things about Odin. And you might say, well, kids, they're not scared of Santa. But actually, in a way, they are, because whenever, and some of you know what I'm talking about, whenever your kids start showing out And they do it in December, like from early December all the way up till Christmas. When your kids are showing out and acting bad, what is it that many of us say all the time? You better quit showing out or else Santa Claus ain't gonna give you nothing. You know he knows if you've been good or bad. If you've been bad, you ain't gonna get nothing for Christmas. And then the kids, they quit crying. Then they start catching their breath and they sit down and they get calm because they're scared to death Santa ain't gonna give them nothing. Or they're scared to death Santa gonna leave them some coal, which is like a punishment for being bad. Right? So yeah. So you see what I'm saying. But that was going on. Also, check this out. There was a goddess that was worshipped by the name of Hertha. And Hertha, it was believed that if Hertha appeared in your fireplace or in the fire of your home, you were going to have good luck. Kind of like how our Santa Claus comes down the chimney and enters in by the fireplace. Yeah, if he comes in, yeah, you're getting some good luck, all right, because you're getting presents for free. But yeah, Hertha, coming into your fireplace in your home. And one of the things that people would do to, I guess you could say, thank Hertha for coming in and blessing them with good luck was they would leave out milk and pastries. Like how we leave milk and cookies for Santa. Yeah. That's what all that's about. It's when we do that, when we leave out the milk and cookies for Santa and we get the kids, you know, making lists and hoping and believing that that Santa's gonna come through. It really, unknowingly, and I know that we don't know any better, we don't mean to, but in a way, it's like a worship, kind of like when we pray to God for something, instead, we're going to Santa with this list of things that we're hoping that we get, and then we got to leave the milk and cookies as a way to thank him, but really, these are reenactments of things that people did back in the day to hope for prosperity and blessings, not from God, but from false gods and goddesses. Leaving out the treats. Speaking of leaving out the treats, I can't wait to get to Halloween, but let me stay on Christmas. I'm not done just yet. So that's what was going on. And you might be thinking, how did it all come down to this? How did we get to a point where we started to accept Christmas and Easter and all these other things? Well, this is what happened. Years ago, this is how it played out. Of course, we have the one true God, and then we had, you know, the false gods. And, of course, our God, the God of the Bible, came in the flesh as Jesus. And so because of what Jesus did, it wasn't just about being Jewish anymore. It was about becoming a Christian, and it was, you know, all about the faith in Jesus and having salvation in Jesus. And so Christianity started to spread like wildfire in a lot of places. They wanted to try to keep it illegal. You know, they were trying to hold on to paganism so bad. But Christianity was just coming at them, man. I mean, it was just going. It was awesome. It was great. And so people started to get desperate. They wanted really bad for Christianity and paganism to merge a little bit. They wanted Christians to be a little bit more pagan friendly and be more accepting to bring in a lot of their customs and traits into the church and into their ways of worship. So there was a pope back then, Pope Gregory I, who demanded that Augustine make some changes to where in the Roman Catholic Church they would begin to accept more things of the pagans, more of their culture, more of the things that they did in worship of their gods into the church. And they also had it set up to where the events, the Christian events, the dates of them would be changed to line up a little bit more with the pagan holidays and celebrations. So our celebrations and events would either be on the same day or, like, you know, close to or on a similar close day to the day that they would be doing things. So the church started adjusting for them. In other words, they were allowing the world and the church, as we say. And the rest is history. But these things started to happen, and they trickled down into the American Christian churches. And what ended up happening was, thanks to all this blending of Christianity and paganism, it all turned into what was called Christ's Mass, or as we now say it, Christmas. But they had Christ's Mass, and what people were doing to celebrate this was, you know, you would think it would have something to do with Christianity because Christ is in it, but it was more pagan than anything else because of the blending that had happened. So even though it was called Christ's Mass, the way that they were celebrating it was people would go out into the streets. They'd have sex right there, just right out in public. There were a lot of riotings going on. People were breaking in and rioting different places. People would get brutally murdered. Men would go and beat their wives. People were just having orgies and going wild. That's what they did during the celebration of Christ's Mass. And there was even a point in time, guys, where certain places here in America banned the celebration of Christ's Mass. And it wasn't people that were Christians. It was people that were Christians, but because they knew of the true origins of it, they wanted it banned. And this was going on in the 1600s. They were having it banned in Boston and other places. So that's how all of that played out. So I want to show you one thing real quick in the Bible about Christmas real quick, and then I'm going to move on to the final one, which is going to be Halloween, and I'm pretty excited about all that. So, of course, let's see here. Of course, I'm excited about getting to Halloween. That one is such an obvious one, an obvious holiday that Christians really shouldn't want to have anything to do with, really. At all. I mean, literally nothing about it has to do with Christ. But anyway, Jeremiah, and I want to look at chapter 10, and I just want to read the first few verses. Like I said, pagans a lot of times are referenced to heathens. Let's look at this. It says this: "Hear ye the word which the Lord speaketh unto you, O house of Israel." So he's talking to his people, the Israelites. Look at this. "Thus saith the Lord, learn not the way of the heathen." So he's saying, don't learn their ways, their customs. Look at this. "And be not dismayed at the signs of heaven, for the heathen are dismayed at them. For the custom of the people are vain. For one cutteth a tree out of the forest, the work of the hands of the workmen with the axe. They deck it with silver and with gold. They fasten it with nails and with hammers that it move not." Some of you probably already know what I'm about to say. And for those of you that don't, it's probably going to rub you the wrong way. You know what I just described, right? Christmas trees. Uh-oh. This ain't going to set well with too many people. Christmas trees. It's describing the ways of the heathen. And what were they doing? They were going out into the forest, cutting down the tree, taking it with them, and then planting it and fastening it that it would stay still, and decorating it with gold and silver, decking it out like how we do with our Christmas trees. Now, some of you might be saying, well, they're not real trees. You go to the store, they're in a box, you buy them. You take the box home, you open it up, you put together this tree that's not a real tree. Yeah, but, and I'm sure some of you older people, you know what I'm talking about. It wasn't always like that. people in recent times would actually get real trees that looked just like the Christmas tree, but it was an actual real tree that had been cut down. It wasn't just one bought from the store, a plastic one with metal parts bought from the store. It was right out of a forest or, you know, somewhere where trees had been growing. And actually, some people today still do that. They still prefer to go and get a real tree and have it cut, and they'll bring it in the house and fasten it down and deck it out with gold and silver decorations and everything else. So that's what that's about. They would get the tree, and it's funny because when I think about it, it almost makes me think of a car salesman. You know, when people, like on the TV commercials, they'll show you all these cars at a car lot somewhere, and you have that one dude who's you know, talking to you, and he's the one that's telling you about all the cars and what's so nice about all the cars and how much they are, and telling you if he'll cut a deal with you, and, you know, hey, I'll give it to you for a lower price if, you know, you pay more up front or whatever. That's kind of how people were with the trees, the actual trees, like, they were actually growing the real trees. There were people that would have their own tree lot somewhere. They would grow trees. And when it got close to Christmas time, people would come through, and the person would show people around, show them the trees. Like, you know, people will show you a car at a car lot. They'll show you stuff about the trees and tell you stuff about them. And you pick a tree out, and they would get somebody to cut that tree down for you. Take that tree, put it on the top of that car, lay it down on the top, and get that rope and tie it down. And they take that tree on home with them and put it up and find a way to keep it fastened down and deck it out. And there you go, the Christmas tree. The more you know, huh? Anyway, but there's that, and a lot of times we have our Christmas parties. A lot of times we have Christmas parties at church, and one of the things we do a lot of times is we put up a Christmas tree in the church. Now, again, going hand in hand with the whole Christmas or with the whole Easter Bunny thing, you know, why call it Easter? Why not call it something else? Why put the tree up and deck it out? Just like, yeah, like the Bible says, you know, what it's saying here, you know, why do that? Why not just do something else? And a lot of people will say, well, we still want to celebrate Jesus. I didn't say you couldn't celebrate Jesus. I didn't say you couldn't celebrate the wonderful birth of Jesus. You know, people will say, well, you know, we're giving gifts to one another, and it's a representation of that moment where the three wise men gave gifts to baby Jesus, gold, myrrh, and frankincense. So that's what it's about. And I understand that it's about family. It's about coming together. It's about Jesus and celebrating the birth of our Savior and giving gifts like the wise man gave unto Jesus. I get that. But again, you don't have to have the tree. But if you want to, hey, you know, okay, I'm just showing you some stuff. You know, I'm just showing you that you can still celebrate things of God and Jesus without holding on to all the pagan attachments. But, you know, whatever. Just pointing that out. But I also want to point out one more thing as I go to Halloween. And it's this. Why not, and I know this is going to be something that will make people feel uncomfortable because they don't want to hurt their children. They don't want their kids to get upset with them. Why not just do away with Santa altogether? And I know some people might be thinking, what? Get rid of Santa Claus, blah, 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 blah. And I know, I understand. But this is why. I believe that if we did that, not only would we make things more about Jesus, especially for the kids, because let's face it, it's more about Santa for the kids. And let's just be honest. Let's call it how it is. Let's not even act funny. You know what I'm talking about. You know it's true. For a lot of kids, even a lot of Christian kids, come on. Let's not even act funny. It is more about Santa and getting a bunch of gifts than it is about Jesus. Hey, you know I'm not lying. I know it rubs you the wrong way, but it's not because I'm lying. It hurts because it's true. Kind of like when people say the truth hurts. Hey, but then again, the Bible says the truth shall set you free. So if the truth can set you free, then why not? Anyway, so, but this is what I mean. And think about this. And you might be saying, you know, how can we make this? How is that going to make things more about Jesus? And how can this make the kids more appreciative? Because I believe by getting rid of Santa, the children will be more appreciative and thankful around Christmas. Well, this is why. If instead you just be honest and say, hey, there's not a Santa, but listen, I'm the one that's buying you these gifts. And here I am saving up money. And I'm using the holiday bonus or Christmas bonus I'm getting at work. And I'm taking all this money that I earned. And I'm taking this money and I'm saving it up and I'm spending it on you, buying many gifts or a few very expensive gifts that I normally could not afford. I'm making the sacrifice for you because I want to give you something and I love you and I just want to show you my appreciation. And I'd even go in detail about the money, about the finances, not to guilt them or make them feel bad, but to show them how much you're really giving up. Show them how much you make and you know what I mean, how much you've been making, and show them just how much money you've given up to give them something. Show them what you've done for them. But also this, when you eliminate Santa Claus, they have no choice but to be more thankful for what you've done, because this is why. When they find out you have been doing this for them, they will understand, if you explain it good enough, the limitations, how they can only do so much, or how you can only do so much. Because when they keep believing in Santa, there's no limitations. They believe they can get whatever they want, however much they want of it. Because they believe in a Santa, in a person that has no limits. They believe in a Santa that is a guy that has these magical powers, that lives in the North Pole with all these elves that do nothing but make toys all the time. He knows all of their heart's desires, all the kids' heart's desires, and in one night he can go all over the world and deliver all of the things that a child could possibly want, no matter how expensive it is, no matter how many gifts a child wants. So this child makes, you know how kids are, they make a long list, and they'll say, ooh, how do I send this letter to Santa? How do I get it to the North Pole? Because they've got this long list of all this pricey stuff that they want, because they think that there's no limit. So it makes them less thankful. All they have to do is hope that Santa gives it to them, and they get it. There's no limit. There's no reality, is what I'm saying. It's just about getting what you want, no matter how much of it you want, no matter how pricey it is. But when they understand that it's all coming from you and that you have a limitation, that you can't always get them literally everything that they want, it causes them to be more appreciative in the long run. Because they look back and they say, wow, I got all this stuff or all this pricey stuff, and it really came from this parent of mine, and they did all they could to do this. I've got to be a little bit more appreciative and thankful, because it's not just somebody pulling it out of their behind or having an elf make it real quick. It's not magic. This is hard-earned money going into what I'm getting. And thus they become more appreciative. They are more thankful for you for getting the stuff for them. Because they're giving the thanks to you, not Santa, not somebody that doesn't exist. You're getting the thanks, which you should get the thanks, because you spent your money, your hard-earned money that you saved up. And then it makes it more about family versus Santa. And then, in turn, when you explain this to them, you can take that moment, instead of talking about Santa Claus and making a list for Santa and taking the letter and pretending you're putting it in the mailbox to send to the North Pole, instead, you can take that moment and explain to them what the season is really about, since it's supposed to be all about Jesus, and say, hey, Jesus, he's our Savior. When he came, when God came here in the flesh, he was born of a virgin, he was a baby, and there were these three wise men that came bearing gifts, and that's what this season is about. It's not about you, son or daughter, getting a whole bunch of stuff. Yeah, we give, but we give in honor and in reverence of our Savior Jesus. It's not about getting everything you want. And when that happens, reality can set into them. It's not about going crazy and getting everything. It's about family, and it's about Jesus, and it's about being thankful for what we get. And when this reality can sit in for people, we can stop doing this bull crap right here, where we do this mess on Black Friday, where we go into the stores and fight people and jump all over people and trample all over people like a bunch of wild animals. And here's the thing about it, folks. Black Friday doesn't necessarily start during the day on Friday these days. It starts late Thursday night. And of course, that Thursday before Black Friday is Thanksgiving. So that means that right after we get done sitting at a dinner table, eating with family, talking about how thankful we are, and praying over the food and thanking God for what all we have and acting like we're so thankful for what we already got, just hours later, we rush to the stores and almost kill some folks just to get some stuff on sale. Even though we were just talking about how thankful we were. Now, how hypocritical of us is that? Just hours later, showing our behinds, being very unchristlike, willing to fight people over stuff that you normally wouldn't fight them for just because you're going to save 5, 15, 20 bucks. Some people don't even fight over the expensive stuff. They fight over towels, guys. Towels. Because they're going to save a couple of bucks. Adults doing this. Adults and kids fight. And the funny thing is, some of the things that you see the adults fight for, they're not even getting it for their kid for Christmas. They're getting it for themselves, like the PlayStations and the Xboxes. I'm a gamer. I love some Xbox, but listen, if fighting somebody over it is not that serious. You think they're fighting over this stuff for their kids, and they're getting it for themselves. It's crazy. So we can eliminate so much nonsense and get Satan or Santa out of the big picture and actually make it to where Jesus actually really is the reason for the season. Oh, I'm sorry. Did that step on toes? You'll be all right. Now, we're gonna move on here to Halloween. And like I said, I shouldn't even have to explain to you the problems with Halloween. I really don't feel like I should have to do that, but that's what we're going to get into. Where do I want to go to first? Go with me to Galatians. Galatians, we're going to start in chapter 5 here. And let me say this, because I used to do this all the time, and I keep trying to remind myself to go back to doing this like I used to in my older audio sermons. Let me say to you guys, thank you right now. Thank you for tuning in. Thank you for listening to sermons. Thank you for whether you're listening or watching on video. Either way, I'm very thankful that you tune in and that you listen and that you enjoy, and I hope that you continue to come back and continue to tune in and listen or watch and hear me rant and rave about a bunch of random stuff all the time. So, like I said, starting in Galatians, let me tell you real quick about Halloween. Let me get a sip of water real quick. Halloween was known as the Day of the Dead or the Festival of the Dead. Now, if we serve the God of the living, you know what I mean? Already, just by me telling you that, you already know this is going to go downhill. Halloween, the Day of the Dead or the Festival of the Dead. And during this holiday, what happened was this. What happened was this. People believed that on this particular day, they believe there was a veil that separated the spiritual realm from the physical realm. And they believed on this particular day, Halloween, that the veil was removed and that it was a time where beings of the spiritual realm could very easily contact us and interact with us and things of that nature. And so they believed that they could see, you know, ghosts wandering around, and that they could also have visitations from lost loved ones or loved ones that have passed on. In other words, communicating with the dead. Now, let me pause and say this before I even continue to talk about Halloween. We as Christians, we should already know that that's a no-no for us. We are not supposed to be trying to bring people back from the dead. Now, if it's somebody that died a long time ago, no. Now, don't get me wrong. I'm not saying that if somebody dies in your arms, you can't pray that God would bring them back. I mean, he did that with Lazarus. But that's not what I'm talking about. Y'all know what I'm talking about. This necromancy thing where, you know, you get what I'm saying. Communicating with the dead. Even if it's somebody that you love so much, when they pass on, they passed on. We don't need to be trying to talk to the dead. We don't need to play with Ouija boards or anything else like that that's going to give us contact with a ghost or anything like that. Because you do stuff like that, you start opening up the door for demonic spirits to come into your life. And it's just not something that you need to do. We should know that as Christians that is a no-no. But that's what they were doing, communication with the dead, seeing ghosts. Now, let me say this also, because a lot of people, I'm sure you're wondering, you're probably thinking, I wonder if she's going to say something about trick-or-treating, because that's the main thing. Yes, I am. What they would do is they believed that these ghosts, when the ghosts were coming into their villages and coming in their neighborhoods, they believed that the ghosts, if they wanted to, could destroy their flock and destroy their homes and their neighborhoods. So what they would do was they would get food and they would set it outside on their doorstep and leave it there. Is a welcoming for the ghosts, almost as if to say, hey, you know, I'm giving you a treat here. You know, don't bother me. Kind of like when we go trick-or-treating and we go up to somebody's doorstep, and when they answer it, we got our hands out wanting something to eat or a nice treat. Yeah. So there's that. Then also you have the pumpkins or jack-o'-lanterns, where we take the pumpkin and we carve a face in it. And we make happy faces in them sometimes, but usually, you know, the jack-o'-lantern has that kind of creepy smile about it. It looks kind of creepy and crazy. And we put a candle or some type of light down in it so Halloween night it'll glow. Well, they did that, but what they did was they used turnips or skulls, because of course skulls have, you know, a face in it already, basically, and they would put a candle or some type of lighting down in it, and that face, that glowing face that it was supposed to make, would represent a demon or a damned soul. So that's what your cute little jack-o'-lanterns are. You know, so there's that. And then they would put on masks or costumes to try to pose as something else to get the attention of ghosts, and they will wear this stuff to lure the ghosts away, to get ghosts to leave, to go somewhere else. And so there we are with our costumes and things that we wear. Some people would say, well, you know, and by the way, we do this in churches. We have the Halloween party where we give out candy, and you might say, what's the big deal? What's the big deal? Well, this is the thing. You might say, well, you know, we're just having fun. It's no big deal, no harm. You know, we're not worshiping any gods or anything like that. We're just giving out candy. We're just letting the kids have a good time. I understand. Nothing wrong with giving away free candy. Well, here's the thing. Why do we have up some of the decorations that we have up, especially in the church and in our homes? See, during Halloween, we have really creepy decorations up. It's supposed to be spooky and scary, but some of the decorations will be things like witches, right? We have decorations and images of witches, and we have images of spell books, you know, the books that they use to cast spells. And then, you know, a lot of times in movies, you'll see a witch standing over this big cauldron, and she's got that wooden stick stirring up the pot. And so we'll have decorations of pots with creepy faces on them where the witch will stir the stuff inside of it up to create a potion or something. So here's the thing. If the Bible is so against witchcraft, which we know that it is, and the people who do witchcraft are witches, you know, or wizards or warlocks or whatever, why is it that we put up these images in the church? Why can't you just give out the free candy or put other decorations up besides people who do things that we say is a sin in the church, but put the decorations of those types of people up in the church? It just doesn't, you know, it's not adding up. But anyway, it's just something to think about. But also, one of the gods that was worshipped during this time was Baal, B-E-L. So go with me to Galatians. I'm sure y'all have probably already turned there since I said it to you, but Galatians chapter 5, and I want to look, starting at verse 19, it says this: "Now the works of the flesh are manifest, which are these: adultery, fornication, uncleanness, lasciviousness, idolatry." Here we are with idolatry, because that's what paganism is. You know, idolatry is when you worship a different god besides the one true God, or it's when you take things or people or whatever and you make them more important than God, or you're putting them in place of God. You worship other things besides God. So that's idolatry, and that's what the big sin of the pagans were, was idolatry, idol worship, worshiping idols and false gods. So verse 20, idolatry, and what does it say right after idolatry? Witchcraft, hatred, variance, emulations, wrath, strife, seditions, hearsays, envyings, murders, drunkenness, revelings, and such the like. Of the which I tell you before, as I have told you in time past, that they which do such things shall not inherit the kingdom of God. So this type of stuff doesn't inherit the kingdom of God, but we can put images of witches up in the house of God. Whatever. Bless our hearts. So, go to 2 Chronicles, and let's look at chapter 33. We're going to start here at the beginning of it, 2 Chronicles chapter 33. It says this: Manasseh was 12 years old when he began to reign, and he reigned 55 years in Jerusalem, but did that which was evil in the sight of the Lord, like unto the abominations of the heathen. Here we go. So he was doing things of the heathen. Let's see. Whom the Lord had cast out before the children of Israel. For he built again the high places which Hezekiah his father had broken down, and he reared up altars for Balaam, and made groves, and worshipped all the hosts of heaven, and served them. Also he built altars in the house of the Lord, wherefore the Lord had said, in Jerusalem shall my name be forever. And he built up altars for all the hosts of heaven in the two courts of the house of the Lord, and he caused his children to pass through the fire in the valley of the son of Hinnom. So here he is. Not only is he setting up altars and places of worship for false gods, but he also causes his children to pass through the fire. In other words, he's causing his kids to be fire sacrificed for false gods. Moving on, it says, also, he observed times and used enchantments and used witchcraft and dealt with a familiar spirit and with wizards, similar to witches, by the way. He wrought much evil in the sight of the Lord to provoke him to anger. And he set a carved image, here we are with carved images, kind of like carving into them pumpkins, images of demons or idols. It says, and he said, a carved image, the idol which he had made in the house of God, of which God had said to David and to Solomon his son, in this house and in Jerusalem, which I have chosen before all the tribes of Israel, will I put my name forever. So, this particular fella made some boo-boos. He did some things which he shouldn't, and we see some things of the heathen that he took on, things very much against God and what God wanted. And we see that there. Witches, wizards, people, a lot of people say, you know, a wizard is like a male witch or whatever. I'm not concerned about gender right now, whether it's witch, wizard, warlock, whatever. It just blows my mind how so many times people will say, hey, you better not let your kids watch Harry Potter and all this other stuff that's got witchcraft in it that's targeted toward the youth and our children. But then we have the Halloween party in the church with the, anyway, with the pictures of the witches. I don't understand. I don't even know. Go to Isaiah 46. Isaiah chapter 46. Oh, I don't understand. What is life? Isaiah 46, starting at verse 1, it says, Baal boweth down. Here's Baal, the god I was telling you about that was worshipped during Halloween. Baal boweth down. Nebo stoopeth. So that's another god, Nebo. Their idols were upon the beasts and upon the cattle. Your carriages were heavy laden. They are a burden to the weary beast. They stoop, they bow down together, but they could not deliver the burden. But themselves are gone into captivity. Hearken unto me, O house of Jacob, and all the remnant of the house of Israel, which are born by me from the belly, which are carried from the womb, and even to your old age, I am he, and even to hoar hairs will I carry you. I have made, and I will bear, even I will carry, and will deliver you. So he's talking about their gods, and he's comparing Baal and their false gods to him, and he's saying, you know, you got these images, you got these idols, they're heavy, you're carrying the weight of them around, but I'm here for you. I'll carry you. You're carrying them and their load, and I'm trying to help carry you and your load. He's comparing himself to them and is showing them there's no comparison. Hands down, he's the one to go for, the one true God. Verse 5, to whom will ye liken me and make me equal and compare me that we may be like? And that's what he's saying here. We're not equal. When you compare us to, we're not equal. How can you compare us? There's no comparison. Verse 6. They lavish gold out of the bag and weigh silver in the balance and hire a goldsmith and he maketh it a god and they fall down. Yea, they worship. They bear him upon the shoulder. They carry him and set him in his place and he standeth from his place. Shall he not remove? Yea, one shall cry unto him. Yet can he not answer nor save him out of his trouble. God is saying, listen, when it all comes down to it, they can't save you. You can make these idols and images out of gold, out of silver. You can get somebody who specializes in this type of stuff to create these images to the best of their ability. You can do all this stuff, make it nice and fancy and beautiful. But at the end of the day, these gods can't save you. I can. So that's what he's talking about with Baal. And now that I've said all this, I've talked about Easter and Christmas and Halloween, I want to take you to one last spot just because I really want to share this. Go to 1 Samuel. think I got my bookmark in the wrong spot. No wonder. Anyway, here we go. 1 Samuel. We're going to be in chapter 5. Starting at verse 1, it says this. And the Philistines took the ark of God and brought it from Ebenezer unto Ashdod. And when the Philistines took the ark of God, they brought it into the house of Dagon and set it by Dagon. Now, of course, we call our church is the house of the Lord, the home of worship for our God. Well, these Philistines took the ark of God, which, like I said, was a representation of God's presence. They took this ark. They weren't supposed to. They weren't even supposed to touch it, but they stole it. They took it, brought it back to their territory, and they put it in the house of Dagon. In other words, a place of worship for this idol Dagon. And so they had this image or this statue up of this god Dagon. And they had to nerve to put the ark of God beside Dagon. Let's see what happens. Verse 3. And when they of Ashdod arose early on the morrow, behold, Dagon was fallen upon his face to the earth before the ark of the Lord, and they took Dagon and set him in his place again. So they leave this place, they come back the next day, and they see this idol, this statue, laid out on the ground in front of the ark of God. And it was almost like God just put it down in its place. And the thing that this makes me think of is when the Bible says that every knee shall bow and every tongue shall confess that Jesus is Lord. And it's almost, to me, it seems almost like a type and shadow or a foreshadowing of what's to come. This idol is made to reverence God. It's down on its face before the Lord. And I think that that is awesome. It's like God's way of saying, I'm not going to have any gods before me, at least not standing up anyway. They can bow down to me, though. They can reverence me as the one true God, though. But they see this and they decide to set Dagon back up. And let's see what it says. It says, and when they arose early on the morrow morning, behold, Dagon was fallen upon his face to the ground before the ark of the Lord, and the head of Dagon and both the palms of his hands were cut off upon the threshold. Only the stump of Dagon was left to him. So they come back again the next day. Dagon is down again, but now he's dismantled. The body of this image is broken in pieces. Verse 5, therefore neither the priests of Dagon nor any that come into Dagon's house tread on the threshold of Dagon in Ashdod unto this day. But the hand of the Lord was heavy upon them of Ashdod, and he destroyed them and smote them with emrods, even Ashdod and the coast thereof. And when the men of Ashdod saw that it was so, they said, the ark of the God of Israel shall not abide with us, for his hand is sore upon us and upon Dagon our God. They got a wake-up call there. They saw this continuing to happen, and they realized the power of God, of the one true God. And they even had to admit there in that last verse, they had to admit, hey, the hand of God, the one true God, is causing us problems, and even our God, Dagon, our God, he's causing trouble for him. They could not deny the power of our God, the Christian God, the God of Abraham, Isaac, and Jacob, the great I am, Jesus Christ. But I love that part in verse 6 when it says that the hand of the Lord was heavy upon them in Ashdod, and it smote them and gave them emrods or hemorrhoids. He gave them hemorrhoids. And that tickles me. It makes me think of how when people today get mad and get angry, we say that they are quote unquote butt hurt. But these people actually literally were butthurt because they had hemorrhoids. That's a funny punishment if you think about it. But anyway, that tickles me. So I wanted to share that to say this. If you have any idols in your life, anything that you put before God, something that you make more important than God, or if you are going a whoring, so to speak, as the Bible puts it, you're going after other gods, you're doing things for other gods. Maybe you're trying to ride the fence and be with certain people and pretend you love God and you're a Christian, and you go over here with some other folks and you pretend to love their God and you pretend to worship the God of their religion. It's not going to work. You can't rot the fence. It's like Elijah said, you cannot be caught between two opinions. Either you're going to serve him or you're going to serve them. So I suggest that you lay down your idols at the feet of Jesus. Lay down your idols the way Dagon was laid down before the presence of the Lord. I'm going to pray us out of here. Heavenly Father, I thank you for another time to minister another word, and I just pray that this special sermon will be a wake-up call to many, something that will make people think, something that will make people want to get to know your word better and dig in more to learn more and to see truths that have been hidden from people for so long, and that people would get to a point where they would say, okay, God, what is of you and what is not of you? And let me go after the things of you so that I am not caught between two opinions anymore. And that I take into consideration what you have to say more than man, even if it means possibly letting go of some old man-made traditions. Lord, I thank you, and I give you the praise, glory, and honor. In Jesus' name, amen.